First of all, I would like to commend the various organisations representing the survivors of the many institutions, the vast array of institutions that formed this architecture of oppression and abuse and persecution that ruined the lives of tens of thousands of women and children, abused them, robbed them of their identities, their histories, and inflicted a crime on people that tens of thousands of vulnerable people and children that really can never be fully, you know, the damage that was done can never be fully undone. And all those groups and organisations deserve great credit and individuals for finally forcing these issues to the forefront and getting the state and the political system to acknowledge that a crime against them has been committed and that as much as is possible must be done to detail the full scale of that crime and provide redress and support to the victims and survivors of that great crime. So the Adoption Rights Alliance, the Irish First Mothers Group, the Justice for the Magdalens, the survivors of the Bethany Homes, of the West Bank Orphanage, and other such institutions, and of course just the many individuals, many of whom didn't survive, haven't survived, will never see justice on this matter. So all of those deserve great tribute for bringing things to this point where finally the state and the government have acknowledged the need for some sort of redress. And it's still hard to get your head around what was done, the scale of what was done, the fact that most of the history of this state was one where this great crime was being committed and where the most powerful people in church and state were overseeing this horrendous treatment of tens of thousands of women and children on the basis of the extraordinary notion of legitimacy and illegitimacy. An incredible thing for a state and a church to have in its head when the founding document of that state, which we will celebrate next year, was one which talked about cherishing all of the children equally, or a church that talked about you know, principles of humanity and decency and the Ten Commandments and all the rest of it. And yet, simultaneously, they could hold in their heads this notion that some people were legitimate people and some people were illegitimate people. And on the basis of that notion, could then stigmatise, abuse, imprison, incarcerate those people and treat them as some subhumans, where all the normal rights and dignities that are accorded to legitimate people are simply denied them and they're treated like animals. It's just extraordinary that that could persist for so long. And even as a young person growing up, this notion was still around. The stigmatisation of single mothers persisted right up until the 1980s and 1990s. Just an absolutely extraordinary, barbaric, uncivilised perspective on life that justified horrendous crimes. And, I mean, I know in myself, as somebody who was adopted through St. Patrick's Guild, whose mother was forced to go to England and give birth to me in a mother and baby home in England, I think that many of the mothers who are in that situation will not be included because the birth and adoption took place in England. They will be outside the terms of reference of this. But in my particular case, I was lucky. relatively lucky because I was adopted by a good family, and luckily my birth mother, although facing very considerable resistance for many years from the institutions that had facilitated these adoptions, fought through that resistance, was persistent, and finally was able to make contact with me. And therefore I was lucky in a way that thousands and thousands of other people have not been lucky, who will never get to see their children or their biological parents, who may never fully recover their history or identities because of the unbelievable architecture of oppression and abuse that existed, and the political cowardice and failure of successive governments to actually address this issue and give redress to the people who were victims of this system. Now, against all of that background, all I would say to the Minister is, while it is welcome that we have finally, as a result of the pressure and persistence of the people who were the survivors of this, got to this point, can we please not fall at the last hurdle and deny people the full justice and the full redress which they are asking for? The idea that we will partially deal with this matter, or decide particular institutions that we will look at, or shine a light on particular parts of this problem, rather than shine a light on the entire architecture which worked in conjunction. All of these institutions, from the state to the church to the various different institutions, they were part of an integrated whole, a system of oppression and the denial of rights, the whole of which we need to shine a light on, and where full justice and redress must be given to all of those that seek it, without any partiality or any restrictions or any limitations on it. So I would just appeal to the Minister, seeing as we've got this far, can we not go the whole way now and ensure that nobody is left outside this, and that we get the truth about it all, and that we get the redress and justice for all of those victims in all of those institutions, and that none are excluded from this belated process of justice and acknowledgement of a great crime.